All right. So it's a great pleasure to welcome Alex Kontorovich from Rutgers.
I can't hear you. Can you speak a little louder?
It's a great pleasure to welcome Alex Kontorovich from Rutgers, who will speak on toric orbits in the affine sieve.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for the invitation. It's always a great pleasure to be back home, I guess, where I grew up. So I wanted to tell you about some fun things I've been thinking about, but let me explain what I'm gonna be doing with the very baby case. So can you see this? Yeah, great.
Yes.
So everybody knows the Fibonacci numbers. You add the previous two things. There's a folklore conjecture. I don't know if anybody knows where this conjecture actually originated or what a reference for it is, but it seems that people believe there are infinitely many primes among the list of Fibonacci numbers. Okay, 13 is a prime. Is 233 a prime? I'm not sure. Maybe 89. Anyway, definitely not 57. So the index of the Fibonacci number has to be prime in order for the Fibonacci number to be prime. That's just a simple consequence of the fact that the Fibonacci numbers are a strong divisibility sequence. So if n divides m, then fn divides fm. And so if fn is prime, then the index n itself must be prime. And let's write big omega of n. This is the standard notation for the total number of prime factors, so counting multiplicity. So for example, 12 is 2 times 2 times 3, and that's 3 prime factors, so big omega of 12 is 3. I'm going very, very slowly to start. And people have given some heuristics for this that suggest that if you run along composite, not the prime indices, but the composite indices, not only is big omega not one or maybe has some lower, you know, has hit small numbers, it diverges, goes off to infinity. So this big omega should be finite for only finitely many values of n, for only finitely many indices. All right, there's some heuristics for this. And maybe, I'm not sure how strong the evidence was for this previously, that big omega of f of n should be at least, maybe it should be growing like log n, which it compares to log of the number, right? The nth Fibonacci number is exponentially large in the index n. I mean, it's golden mean to the n. So far, so good. Everything is clear. So let's consider, certainly if the index is even, then it's composite. And let's look at big omega of f of 2n divided by log n and see what happens as n goes to infinity. Now, let me just remind you, as I said already, 2n has n as a divisor. So f2n divided by fn will be an integer. And that integer is called the nth Lucas number. So the Lucas numbers start with 1, 3 instead of 1, 2, and then have the same pattern as the Fibonacci numbers. You add 1 and 3, you get 4. You add 3 and 4, you get 7, and so on. Okay. Any questions? This is all very baby stuff so far. So far, so good. Okay, so let's look. So the reason I'm talking about Fibonacci numbers, the reason I'm talking about Fibonacci numbers is that someone, so there's this website, mersenis.net, where people have computed as much as they can, at least partial factorizations of up to the 10,000th Fibonacci number. So these are numbers with like 10,000 digits or maybe 5,000 digits, decimal digits, okay? These are huge numbers and they've been factored as best as possible. And sometimes what the data will report is something like, I can tell you that there are X, Y, and Z are prime factors. And then there's a number that's composite, but it has 1,000 digits and I can't find a single prime factor, okay? So in that case, what I'll do, so we have data for the nth Fibonacci number and the nth Lucas number. So we can take the total prime factorizations. And if I have only partial data, what I'll do is, this is really, so if what I know is that Fn is equal to some primes, P1 through Pk, times a composite, where this is composite, then in the data, what I say is big omega of this Well, it's at least k plus one.
Are p1 to pk small primes or big primes?
Doesn't matter big or small, they're just known primes. So if fn can be factored into known primes times a composite, or maybe several composites, but I'm just looking at this simple case, then all I know is that in this data, what I will plot is the smallest possible value of big omega. Does that make sense? So you take big omega of fn times fl, which of course is the sum. This is big omega of fn plus big omega of ln. And I divide by log n. So what you're seeing here, I mean, if it looks like a bunch of curves, these are all curves r over log n, where r is the number where this sum is r. So over the various values of r, you have these level sets r one over log times one over log x. Okay? But it really looks like it's not nearing the origin. It's not getting close to zero. So it really looks like the 2nth Fibonacci numbers have a total number of prime factors, which really is growing at least like log n. Does that make sense? So far, at least that's what the data is showing. So the thing that I want to report is conjecture, is joint work with Jeff Ligarius, where we think we identify exactly the liminf of this sequence. And it's a number that we call beta 2, as you'll see why in a second, but it's about 0.37. So 0.37 is right about there. And let me show you the same picture with beta of 2. So this is the number that we've identified a new number related to the Fibonacci sequence. And I want to convince you that this is a reasonable conjecture to make. Any questions so far? Does this make sense, what the question is? Okay, so notice that there's this one guy here. I mean, everybody's above beta of 2 except for this one guy. So let me tell you about this one guy. This one point is at index 8467 or whatever. At that value, L, the nth Lucas number, is known to be prime, but the nth Fibonacci number is a composite number with 1700 decimal digits and no known prime factors. And so here I estimate that Fibonacci number has big omega of 2, although it might be more. It might be the product of two 900 decimal numbers, 900 decimal primes, or it might be a product of three 600 decimal primes. And we just can't find any of them. So if this estimate is incorrect, actually, then this will bump up to being over the line. But actually, the conjecture is about a liminf. So you're allowed to be below the red line infinitely often, as long as the amount by which you go under shrinks as you go out to infinity, right? I'm just reminding you what liminf means. All right, this is some stupid conjecture about the Fibonacci's. Maybe it's useless. Let's see. Let's take the nth Mersenne number. The nth Mersenne number, I just mean 2 to the n minus 1. Of course, there should be infinitely many Mersenne primes, so we think. And if we look at whether or not there are Mersenne twin primes, so I look at the n minus first Mersenne number and the n plus first Mersenne number, and I look at the product of those two, I take the total number of prime factors. Again, thankfully, someone else has done the hard work of working on the partial factorizations of all of these things. And here's the data for big omega of this product divided by log n. And again, in this case, we conjecture that it's the same liminf beta of 2. The data, I don't know how convincing this data is. Maybe we have to go farther before we see that it really is the liminf. But I don't know. I don't know if you're convinced. I'm going to show you one more example, and then I'm going to state a general theorem or principle. Any questions so far? Okay. One more setting. So let's look at affine quadrics. So we have some quadratic form. Q of xy is ax squared plus bxy plus cy squared. I want it to be indefinite. So that means the determinant b squared minus 4ac is positive. It takes both positive and negative values. And I want it to be non-degenerate. So this discriminant is positive, and I want it to be not a perfect square. This is a quadratic form over z. So the entries a, b, c are integers. And I'll fix some value, some integer t, so that if we look at the affine quadric, q equals t, so that's some variety. I'm drawing the real points. This is v of r. I want this to be non-empty over z. So these points here, hopefully you can see them. This is the integer points on this variety. Can you see that? Yeah. So the example here is the quadratic form x squared minus xy minus 3y squared. It has discriminant 1 plus 12 is 13. That's the discriminant. And let's take t equals 1. And I'll let you work out what the points are. So it's homogeneous. So we can take so it's symmetric under 180 degree rotation. So this is the point 10 and negative 10 and 4, negative 3 and 7, comma 3. And then they get bigger and bigger. And of course, they grow exponentially, right? The values. And we look at the map that takes a point xy in the integer quadric and sends it to the real number big omega of x times y. But now we could order them, or we could just look at log of x times y, which will have the same effect as dividing by log n if n is the nth entry in this sequence. Okay, the problem is now no one's done the work for me, so I have to do this myself. And if I do it myself, well, the computer runs out at about 100. So these are numbers with 200 decimal places. Probably some of you can push this computation much farther than I'm willing to sit and wait for Mathematica to give me the factorizations. So this is really far from conclusive evidence, but for comparison, here's the number beta of 2 that one may expect to be the lower bound of this big omega divided by log. And here's a slightly larger picture. I can't get very far because it's hard to factor, but the conjecture of Ligarius and myself would say that if you look at the total number of prime factors of the products of the entries, so I have points x and y, I have points x, y in the variety, and I look at the products of the entries of those points, I take the total number of prime factors, divide by roughly log n or log xy, then there's a liminf, that the liminf is at least this number 0.37. Okay, any questions on these conjectures so far? So far, so good. All right.
Do you expect the limit to exist?
The limit or the liminf?
The limit.
The limit, I don't expect to exist. No, I think it's going to go all over the place.
It's just going to be always greater than that.
Yeah, asymptotically. Yeah. So for any epsilon, there will only be finitely many points for which this ratio is less than beta 2 minus epsilon.
So what about quadrics with more variables?
In more variables, the answer will not be, as you'll see in a second. So it's certainly... What I'm using about this, about binary quadrics, is that their orthogonal groups are not semi-simple. Their orthogonal groups are hyperbolic. They're algebraic tori. And that's exactly what I'm coming to right now. So let me remind you of the affine sieve theorem, initiated by Brigand, Gebhardt, Sarnak. When the Zariski closure is GL2. Or SL2, and Salehi, Golsafidi, Sarnak in the general case. So here's what you do. You take gamma to be some finitely generated subgroup of GLN QZ. So you take a finite number of matrices, n by n matrices, invertible with rational entries. That's all that gamma is. And you take the group generated by those, and let G be the algebraic group scheme, which is the Zariski closure of gamma. You take your favorite base point, V0 in Q to the n. So V0, so this is R to the n. V0 is some base point and I want to take a rational point, so that I take a rational orbit. So the orbit gamma acts on V0, and I get some orbit O, which is gamma acting on V0. Okay, so that's some number of points in space. And you take your favorite polynomial, which has integer values on the orbit. So I have some polynomial F, which sends me to the integers. I don't want something stupid. I don't want this polynomial to be constant on some irreducible component of the Zariski closure of the orbit itself. Maybe the orbit is a quadric, or maybe the orbit is Zariski closure of the orbit is some subvariety. I don't want F to be constant on some irreducible component. And here's the key assumption that distinguishes, exactly to your question, Yuri, that distinguishes two variable quadratic forms from three and higher, is for two variables, the connected component of the identity of the Zariski closure of the orthogonal group preserving that quadratic form will exactly be an algebraic torus. So I want that no algebraic torus is a homomorphic image of the connected component of the identity of G, which is the Zariski closure of gamma. That's the key assumption in the affine sieve theorem. And the conclusion is that the pair, this orbit, the orbit, which is given by the data of a base point and a group action, and this polynomial F, so this pair OF, saturates in the sense that there is some R, so that if you look at the R almost prime, so this means that F of V is R almost prime. So you look at the Vs, you look at the points in the orbit that are R almost prime. So these are the special points that have, so that F, the value of F has at most, is a product of at most R primes. And you look at the Zariski closure of that set, that Zariski closure should be the same as the Zariski closure of the orbit itself. So you're filling out the full variety, whatever the variety is that the orbit sits on, when you look at the R almost prime points along F, that still fills out the whole variety. Does that make sense?
Okay, so how about upper triangular matrices? Suppose gamma is Heisenberg group or something.
Beautiful, no problem. No problem. If it's Heisenberg group, let's look in SL2. If it's this group,
right,
then you're doing classical sieve theory.
Yeah.
Then the polynomial is just F of N. Absolutely. And the fundamental theorem of just regular old sieve theory tells you that there's some R almost prime for any polynomial on N. And so this is the group version of that.
And so if you do a more complicated upper triangular group, you have a result.
Exactly. So non-abelian, doesn't have to be abelian, doesn't have to be, it doesn't have to be, it doesn't even have to be a lattice inside. This applies to thin groups, right? That's the beauty of this method, is all I assume is that it's a Zariski dense group. Well, it's Zariski dense in something that that isn't an algebraic torus.
Now, can you have a refined statement where you take into account the toral part? Because presumably you would know it would kind of split off in whatever you're doing.
That's right. So there can be a toral part as long as there are other parts. So I can't have a homomorphic image of the of G. I need to have something that I can work with. So actually, as long as you have either unipotents, so unipotents already, if you have a single unipotent, you're basically already done, because then you can use classical techniques. You have an injection of affine space mm-hmm. into these points. Yeah. Either you use unipotents or you use some other kind of elements. I mean, I think, did Ali Reza speak here recently? Maybe on, probably on other things, but this is something, or maybe Alex Gambert talked about this. Anyway, so this is kind of a, well, it's not a recent result. It's not a recent result. Now, there's a very good reason for this assumption. And in the appendix to this paper, Ali Reza and Peter give a heuristic argument, basically Borel-Cantelli, that says if you do have a torus, if the Zariski closure of gamma is a torus, which you know, if you take a single hyperbolic element, like gamma is a single hyperbolic element, then the Zariski closure, of course, is a torus, so ZCL. The C points are just C star, not algebraic torus. Then the number of points in a ball is too small to sieve. Like the number of Fibonacci numbers up to X is only log X. There's only log X indices of Fibonacci numbers grow exponentially. So that's what's bad about a torus. If you have a sequence that grows exponentially, you can't possibly sieve on such a sequence. There's just too few points. In order to sieve, you need to have a power savings error. You need uniformity. You need to understand what's happening to the sequence along arithmetic progressions with a power savings error. But if the number of points is a power of log, how are you supposed to get a power savings from, there's just too few points to say anything. Does that make sense? So for example, we do not know even today that in the Fibonacci numbers, there are infinitely many numbers that are products of 100 prime factors. Not only on the composite Fibonacci's, just on any sequence of Fibonacci. So they give a Borel-Cantelli heuristic that says on a torus, it's possible the total number of prime factors goes to infinity. And the main heuristic assumption is basically an exponential version of a model in Hardy and Wright, that the prime factorizations of different values of FV or each a reducible factor has all of these prime factorizations are independent. So they don't know about each other. If F is a product of K irreducible components, then each of those irreducible components is some random number of that size, has the number of prime factors, has the same number of prime factors as a random number of that size. Okay? And so what Jeff Ligarius and I wanted to do is to make this model precise. And it turns out you can make this model precise and solve exactly for the limiting behavior. And that's where these numbers beta, this number beta two, if you recall, there's this number beta two, which was 0.37 something. That's where it's coming from. So let me tell you about this model. So you fix an integer k. That is the number of irreducible components of F. So F is really F1 times Fk. Then you fix a constant C, which is the growth rate. The growth rate, but actually it washes out in all of the estimates. So you can sort of ignore that there was a fixed constant C. For each integer n, you look at the following ensemble. So you look at the integers 1 to C to the n. So each time, for each n, you get to draw out of an exponentially larger ensemble. And you take a k-tuple of such numbers. So this is x1n, x2n, and so on, xkn. Each of these is bounded by c to the n. And you draw them uniformly. Then the theorem is that if you take the product of these k components, and you take the total number of prime factors of that product, and you divide by log n, that has a limit that you can evaluate exactly. And this number bk is the root of this transcendental equation. So in the case of k equals 2, if the value of f is basically the product of two components, then so this f2 is just some curve. And there's a root right there. And that's this value beta 2 that I've been talking about. And the conjecture, all of the previous conjectures come from applying this model to particular examples. So let me give you kind of a generalized version of this. So here's the general GL2 toral affine sieve conjecture. So you take a matrix, gamma. Take some hyperbolic matrix. So hyperbolic just means it has two real distinct eigenvalues. And you let gamma be the group or even the semigroup generated by them. So these are the positive powers of your matrix. Again, the Zariski closure of such a thing is a torus. the integer point, the complex points are the torus C star. You fix a base vector exactly as before. You look at an orbit, gamma V zero, and you assume that the orbit is integral and infinite. You want it you don't want the Zariski closure to be just a finite set of points. Then the conjecture says that the liminf is not equal to beta, but it's at least beta. And there's a very good reason for this. Already over GL2, the sequence may have hidden reducible factors that are not obvious from the fact that the polynomial here, f of xy, is x times y. So it obviously has two reducible components, but it might have more we don't have a general method to determine the right value of beta k, but I want to show you how in practice you can identify what the number of irreducible components should be.
You mean reducible over the ground field or geometrically reducible? I mean,
it's very hard to explain what we mean by reducible in this case. So let me show you some examples that we'll try to. It's not reducible in any of those senses. It's some new notion of reducibility. Okay. At least as far as I can tell. So the first thing you might think of is the nth Fibonacci number times the n plus first Fibonacci number. Isn't this a product of two numbers? So shouldn't we be getting beta 2? As you can see, the evidence suggests we should be getting beta 3. So let's see if the graduate students can see why. This is the sense in which it's not irreducible. Either one of n or n plus 1, one of these is even. And if it's even, remember that f of 2k is fk times lk. The 2kth Fibonacci number is a product of the kth Fibonacci number and the kth Lucas number. So automatically, you have at least three numbers that you know that this product of two, seemingly product of two numbers, is really a product of three numbers. So Yuri, this is what I mean by it has more, it has farther, more irreducible components.
Very strange.
That is apparent, right?
Very strange.
It's not something that I don't know how to rigorously explain. But in practice, it seems to do a rather good job. I have a whole bunch more examples for you where you can sort of smell what the limiting behavior should be. And the model seems to be, I mean, out to 10,000, which maybe you could say is not so big, but these numbers are getting exponentially large. I can't factor things this large.
All right, so let me try. So you live on a torus, so it's like Laurent polynomial, it's a character of a torus.
Yes.
So is that some kind of reducibility in terms of Laurent polynomials? I mean, we know what these fn's are, you know, lambda to the n, lambda 1 to the n, lambda 2 to the n. So you take the eigenvalues of your characteristic polynomial, you write your expressions, and then you try to factor this, but now you factor in terms of Laurent polynomials. Then you would get me, I think, 3 in this case.
Well, won't the same thing? So if you look at the nth Lucas, in a few slides, I'm going to show you the nth Lucas number times the n plus first Lucas number.
Yeah.
And their beta seems to be 2.
Yeah. So.
But this has the same characteristics as, it has the same asymptotic expression as the nth Fibonacci number. It has the same.
Yeah, and I would look at the exact shape of these Laurent polynomials.
Uh-huh.
But I don't know. I mean, I see it the first time, so
I'm
just fantasizing. I mean,
it's this strong divisibility property.
Yeah.
That I don't know how to see algebra geometrically.
Yeah.
It's very arithmetic.
I'm trying to suggest it. Okay, so you look at this lambda 1 to the n, lambda 2 to the n.
Yes.
You write these polynomials, and you try to factor this.
Right, so these are polynomials.
Those are your polynomials. And of course, if you have like an even number there.
Yes.
And you know what lambda 1, lambda 2 are in these cases.
Yes, then this does factor further.
That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah, that's definitely what's happening.
But I would look at these explicit expressions.
Yes.
So now that we are at this, I want to mention a beautiful theorem of Carvalho-Tangier that's kind of related to this.
Please.
That we came across in some other context, and it goes like this. You take sequences, I mean, we know this, recursive sequences, okay? So you'll take, let's say you have two, like F and G,
uh-huh.
F of N and G of N.
Okay.
So assume that the sequence is not that it goes to infinity as N goes to infinity. In other words, it's not minus one to the N or something like this.
Okay.
So if F of N divides G of N for infinitely many N.
F of N divides G of N infinitely often, uh-huh.
Then it divides it for all N.
Ha. Huh.
So this is a non-trivial result in arithmetic geometry, actually.
And, so what's the condition on F and G again? That there's some recursively defined?
The condition is that it's the roots, the characteristic polynomial, it's not the roots of unity.
Uh-huh.
So that the sequence actually goes to infinity.
Uh-huh.
And of course, I mean, okay, you don't have this to be integers, this can be algebraic integers and so on.
Huh.
And so we used this in an algebraic geometric context where the F and G were the number of FQ points on abelian varieties. These are also recursions because of the Weyl conjectures.
Uh-huh.
Anyway, so it's in a paper of Bogomolov and myself, like Torelli's theorem over finite fields. But that result is sort of an Hamiltonian paper by Corvaille-Zanier. And it might be relevant for what you do because it's these kind of divisibilities that you're struggling with.
Absolutely.
And the issue is that, the theorem is that, of course, when you have like infinitely often divisibility,
yes,
that means that the corresponding Laurent polynomials divide each other. And that's how you get it, that it's for all N.
Uh-huh.
Because, well, this is how it is.
Ah, beautiful. Oh, we definitely have to look at this.
So since you guys are looking at, it's kind of when is one sequence dividing the values of another sequence, well, it does so if those Laurent polynomials divide them.
Beautiful. Oh, wonderful. Okay, I have to look
it
at
it. Might be relevant. So, but
yeah, thanks.
Even if it's not relevant, it's just a beautiful result.
Yes. No, I think it is relevant actually, because the nature of all of the ones that I'm about to show you is of this kind of nature, where one divides the other, but in a secret way that you don't, unless you know to look for it, you.
Well, if it's a secret way, then it's precisely the condition about Laurent polynomial.
Yeah. No, I have to look at that. Thank you.
And so we applied it to a very thin sequence of integers. So in our like Torelli theorem.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it's on my webpage if you want. You
find great. It.
But it has to be this Laurent polynomial, how it factors. It has to be that condition.
Great. Thank you. Yeah, I'm going to look at that. I'm about to show you some more examples of this, but this might actually explain why this is good. I'm getting everything I needed out of this lecture, which was to hear this theorem, Yuri. Right, and this is obviously a case of the above, because you take gamma to be the Fibonacci generating number and V0 is just picking off the nth Fibonacci numbers. In the case of the Mersenne numbers, which again will have the same structure as above. These can also be realized as the orbit of some matrix, of a single matrix. And if you look at the n and n plus first, again, one of these is even and hence has this extra factorization, as Yuri mentioned. And again, this seems to beautifully, I think, you tell me if you agree, match the number beta 3 coming out of the calculation. You can look even higher. If you take the even indices of Fn and Ln, then Fn has an extra divisibility And so inside, this was the picture, this was the first picture I showed you about nth Fibonacci number and nth Lucas number. This is F2n, 2n. But now I'm hiding the odd entries and only looking at the even entries. And along the even entries, sitting inside the odd entries, was this beta 3 picture because of the extra factorization now of n, of fn one step further. So all of this, I think we should be able to catch from what Yuri just said.
Yeah, so the setup is you take arbitrary recursive sequences, you look at the roots of the characteristic polynomial, and you look at the subgroup and see star is spent by these roots. So it's some, finite rank, whatever. So for simplicity, you assume that there is no torsion. Torsion just means that you're like plus minus one, hopping back and forth is kind of irrelevant.
Yeah.
And then you, each sequence, each recursion gives rise to one of these Laurent polynomials. And so, and then the statement holds the one that I gave you.
Yeah. But
now it doesn't have to be a quadratic recursion. It can be a recursion of, any degree that could be relevant for your stuff.
Yeah.
And so then you get, divisibility with now polynomial and many variables, right?
Yeah, beautiful.
So it just means that one lattice is sitting in another lattice. The lattice spent by the characteristic polynomial in C star multiplicatively. By the roots of the characteristic polynomials.
Great.
And so, And again, it doesn't even have to be the recursions don't even have to be of the same degree. It's kind of irrelevant.
Yeah, but you'll see that in the roots.
Yeah, so you see that.
Beautiful. Yeah. All right, well, let me speed through just one more of these examples, I think, which is, now it's really hard to see what's going on. If you take the 2nth Fibonacci number and the 2n plus 2th, so each of these is even and one of them is further even. So now it looks like the number of irreducible components should be 5, except this is not such a good picture, although maybe now where I'm really exhausting the fact that I don't have true factorizations. Maybe these errors in factorizing are piling up. That's one reason that I'm not getting a clean picture here. And as I said, if you look at the nth Lucas number and the n plus first, again, this is plausibly beta of 2, but less conclusive. Anyway, all right, that was just some data. Here's the kind of next order question. So the lim inf of this ratio is beta k. So let's say you give me some number r, and you want to know when is the last time that this thing is equal to r. What's the largest n for which the product of these k factors is equal to r? Okay, so that's this parameter, that's this random variable n. It's the largest integer n for which big omega is equal to r. Now, if you very naively just treat this as an equality, then that tells you what, and you solve for n, n should be e to the r over bk. And the question is that a reasonable size for how far out you have to go? Okay, so that's the next theorem. These are the only two theorems. Everything else is conjectures. Then the next theorem says you look exactly in the same model. So you have some integer k, which is number of irreducible factors. I need at least two irreducible factors because if I have just one, then I'm looking at Fibonacci's themselves. And that we think will be prime infinitely often. Same thing with Mersenne numbers themselves. Here's the growth rate. For each n, you draw a vector x1 through xn in this ensemble uniformly. And let x, big X, be the set of these samples, one for each integer n. And let n be the largest value of little n for which big omega of this draw is bounded by r, the number of prime factors. So you fix some r. Of course, you should take r to be at least the number of components because otherwise it's clear what's going on. The theorem says that with probability one, this n is finite. So with probability one, there is some point after which you never again see a product of r prime factors. Of course, that's exactly what we expect. We expect it to grow like log. But here's the kind of surprising thing. The expected value of this random variable, the expected value of this largest maximum, or at least this k minus first moment, is infinite. So in particular, if k is equal to 2, then this is just the expected value of n itself is infinite. So what that means is that the equation omega is equal to your favorite r could have gigantic sporadic solutions, right? With probability 1, this number n is finite, but the expected value of this number n is infinite. Okay, that's what the model says. So we believe that there could be very large sporadic solutions to omega equals r. So let's see some examples. So let's take k equals 2 and r equals 2. And we look at the set of integers for which we look at the nth Fibonacci number and the n plus 2th Fibonacci number. And when is this product? Now, if n is odd, then n plus 2 is also odd. So there's no funny business with extra factorizations. When is the last time that we have a twin Fibonacci prime? So this would be a twin Fibonacci prime. In other words, n is prime and n plus 2 is prime and fn is prime and fn plus 2 is prime. In other words, so for these two to both be prime simultaneously so that you get exactly two prime factors. The naive heuristic would suggest that the largest value of this set would be the exponent of r over beta k. R is 2, beta k is beta 2, this number 0.37. And if you work out what that is, that says roughly 200. And you look in Neil Sloan's encyclopedia and you find that this set, so you can compute this set out to a million because people, as I said, people don't have factorizations, but it's much easier to see if something is prime or not than it is to factor, right? Primes isn't P, factoring, at least as far as I know, I can still use my credit card online. So factoring has not been shown to be in P. I don't know. Do people think factoring is in P? I know Peter Sarnak thinks that factoring can be done in polynomial time, but many others think conversely. So braids, I think, Dorian, braids are probably safe, but factoring maybe not. Anyway, so the largest entry is this 569. So this is the largest number. So 569 is prime, 571 is prime, and the 569th Fibonacci number is prime, and the 571st Fibonacci number is also prime. And that seems to be the very last time that that happens. Similarly, if you look at the Lucas number, the nth Lucas number, the n plus 2th Lucas number, then the points out to a million where both of these are simultaneously prime, the largest value is 17, which is on the same order of magnitude. But here's something that is totally crazy, and I never would have expected something like this to be true if we hadn't seen this possibility of huge sporadic solutions. If you look at the nth Fibonacci number and the nth Lucas number, can they both be simultaneously prime? So they are simultaneously prime for a bunch of numbers up to 47. And then out to a million, there's this crazy number, 148,091. At this index n, 148,091, both the nth Fibonacci number and the nth Lucas number, which have 30,000 decimal digits, pass every primality test that's been thrown at them, but they're too big to rigorously certify that they are indeed prime. And so it seems like these numbers, these huge 30,000 digit numbers, are simultaneously prime. And we should not be so shocked by the existence of such a number, precisely by if you are happy with applying this theorem, that the random model suggests that the largest value has infinite expectation. Does that make sense? So I don't know. We never would have thought to even look at this data this way, if not for this question. But it's sitting right there. So this is the largest value for which the nth Fibonacci, and the nth Lucas number seem to be simultaneously prime. And presumably never again. I mean, it's the same thing with Fermat primes, right? We don't know if Fermat primes are infinitely many Fermat numbers are prime. But Borel-Cantelli type arguments suggest that no, there should only be finitely many such. Okay, in the last few minutes, let me just give you some very quick ideas in the proof. So of course, what you need to understand if you want to apply this model is how many integers there are up to t with a given number of r prime factors. If r is fixed and t goes to infinity, then it's very well known. It's like, very shortly after the prime number theorem, people saw that this is asymptotic to t over log t. And then there's this factor log t to the r minus one divided by r minus one factorial. So that's how many numbers up to t. If r is equal to one, then this is the prime number theorem. If r is equal to two, how many numbers are exactly products of two primes, and so on. Okay, so this is a very well-known estimate. But in our case, we want to take t to be something like c to the n, and we want to take r to be something like log of this, which is log n. Which is log of t. So in particular, r needs to be growing with t. And Selberg could have proved this theorem. There's nothing that we're using, no technology that we're using that wasn't available to Selberg. Selberg introduced some clever techniques to give an estimate for this n, even when r is growing with t. So I'm going to define this function. Let's see if you can see this. So this is a product over all primes, 1 minus z over p inverse, and 1 minus 1 over p to the z. So if you notice that the first order terms exactly cancel, so actually this function is meromorphic all the way out to real part of z bigger than 0. And of course, it has poles whenever z is a prime. So this is a 3D plot of this thing. So this is the prime 2, the prime 3, 5 and 7 and so on. These are all poles, actually. We should be seeing big spikes at the prime values. And it's meromorphic all the way out to real part of z is bigger than 0. And the limit as z goes to 1, the limiting value here is 1. Okay, that's what this is saying. Does this make sense? Okay. Then the theorem, and again, this is a classical result. As long as r is less than 2 minus epsilon times log t, then we have a uniform estimate for nt of r, which is this main term, t over log t, the prime number theorem, log t to the r minus 1 over r plus r minus 1 factorial, times the value of this function nu, with an error that's like r over log t squared. And r is like log t. So this is definitely little o. This, again, r is of size log t. So this whole thing is little o of 1. It's going to 0. But let's look at this. The reason I need r to be less than, so r minus 1, nu has a pole at 2. 2 is the first place where we have a pole, and 2 is the first place where this behavior, the behavior of this function, genuinely changes. It has different behavior when total number of prime factors is less than twice log t to when it goes to the other side of log t. So you have to do something else. And then, well, this is kind of the main ingredient. And then you do standard analytic and probabilistic techniques, things like Borel-Cantelli and so on. And that gives the main theorem. So maybe I'll stop there and take your questions. So thanks for your attention.
Great.
Are there any questions?
So you mentioned this sporadic example for the product of Fibonacci and Lucas numbers.
Yes.
Are there similar examples for, let's say, Mersenne primes?
Let's see. I think I looked. Maybe I didn't record it here. So Mersenne, so this would be like the nth. Yeah, so I don't remember, but it would be something like the nth Mersenne prime. So P would have to be a prime, Mn would have to be a prime, and P plus 2 would have to be prime, and the nth Mersenne number would have to be prime. I don't remember off the top of my head, but it's something of this flavor. It's not, there's not something crazy, if I recall correctly. There's not some crazy value out to a million where these are small. Where these are both, where big omega is small, where big omega is like 2. So this list, the set of n for which this is 2, we could look it up now if you really like, but I think it's something like, it's the last one is less than 1,000. If memory serves right.
I see. Is there some sort of explanation for this structural difference?
My only explanation for why this shockingly large guy isn't so shocking is exactly that the model predicts the existence, the potential existence of huge sporadic solutions. There's no bound. There's absolutely no, in other words, this bound is completely naive. Then naive, not just in the sense of, well, we don't know, maybe it is wrong, maybe it is right. No, there's kind of no reason for this bound to be right. It's, we have no a priori estimate for how large the set of N of such a problem would be. And that's illustrated by the fact that here there's something that's order of magnitudes larger than what you might expect it to be.
So I want to make another remark related to this. So here is a theorem of Bugeaud, Corbeil, and Zanier from 2003. I will send you the
link, please.
And all of that. And it goes like this. So suppose you have A and B that are multiplicatively independent,
okay,
natural numbers. So then there is some constant, so that if you look at the GCD between A to the N minus one and B to the N minus one, uh-huh, and take a log of this GCD, then it's less than epsilon times N plus a constant for all N.
Hmm.
So what does it mean? So A to the N minus one, B to the N minus one, as you can, of course, it's your recursion. You take two recursive sequences, you assume that they're independent, then there is a uniform bound on the GCD between these.
Huh.
So this again is the result from arithmetic geometry. It's the Diophantine approximation on tori. It's like Schmidt's subspace theorem and things like this. It's like Mordell conjecture, but for integral points on tori.
Uh-huh.
And so this is actually a theorem in this content. So I'm going to send you those papers.
Yeah, please.
And again, it works. So what I said, it's just for, you know, simple recursions, like with one characteristic root or so, but you can do it in general. And so these are special cases of Wojtas conjecture, actually, that are proved. It's Wojtas conjecture on tori. So you can bound those GCDs. So the way you think about GCDs in our context, these are finite heights. And so when you bound the GCD, you're actually bounding the height.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And Wojtas conjecture says you can't have too many integral points with respect to something and so on and so on. So in particular, the results that I just gave you, it's a Wojtas conjecture on GM times GM. Using Schmidt's subspace theorem. So, and then you can push it and they have done so. Anyway, I'm gonna send you slides of a talk that I gave 10 years ago.
Please,
Where this was kind of an introduction to our Anabelian geometry there, Torelli for curves. You can ignore sort of the second half of that. That's like curves on K3 surfaces or finite fields and, you know, other applications. But I think for your estimates, I mean, you're worried about these GCDs between Fn and Ln in this case.
Well, it's not if the GCD could still be one.
Yeah.
It could be totally coprime. It's just that each one of them could have large prime factors.
Yeah, that too, yes.
Or, so it's somehow, but it, I definitely should look at it. It's
all right. Yeah. That's all from me.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Yeah, have you looked at doubly exponential sequences like the Fermat numbers, 2 to the 2 to the n plus 1?
Yeah, so I mentioned that that's another sequence to which, you know, Borel-Cantelli arguments would suggest that there's only finitely many primes among those. Unlike Fermat's conjecture.
Fermat thought they were all prime.
He thought they were all prime, yeah. And the first few are, so of course that sequence continues.
I think the fifth one isn't.
Yeah. As far as I know, can
you get any kind of results about the number of prime factors? But that's because it's also a recursive sequence.
It's also recursive, but as you said, it's doubly exponential.
Right.
So it's another case where, I mean, if you look at 2 to the n plus 1, how do you know that 2 to the n plus 1, I mean, there's algebraic methods that tell you 2 to the n plus 1 can't be prime unless n is 2 to the p. So maybe that's closer to what Yuri was saying about understanding where the roots, the substructure of roots,
mm-hmm.
That would explain. Yeah, so it looks like the sequence is only exponentially growing, but actually the relevant sequence is doubly exponential.
Yeah, so the hidden conditions that might look like this. So coming back to what I said, so you look at the subgroup of C star spent by the characteristic roots here and there. Mm-hmm. So these are lattices. So they could have a common sublattice. They could be an intersection. They could be totally disjoint. And of course, you won't really see this unless you're looking at those lattices.
Yeah.
So, and that's the visibility of Laurent polynomials. And, well, anyway, so.
Yeah, that's great. That might be a really good way of phrasing this K condition.
Yeah.
Well, again, but as you said, you don't know the divisibility until you look.
Well, you know, if you know, it's the Laurent polynomial that's relevant. If you have a recursion, you know the roots.
Mm-hmm.
And so you just need to look at how many of those are dependent.
Yeah.
And it's the rank of that lattice that's relevant. That's probably your K. That's beta K. 2, beta 3. It's simply the rank of the common lattice of the roots for these recursions.
Yeah, that would be a great...
Something like this.
Yeah, that would be a great way to recognize K, at least.
Yeah,
K.
Well...
I mean, none of these things, I don't think any of these things are provable. They're so far outside of current technology. Prime factors of Fibonacci numbers. So they remain conjectures.
It's experimental mathematics and it's best. Yeah. So you see this, and if you can match it to something else, well, then that's all there is to it.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Any other questions? Well, if not, let's thank Alex for his wonderful talk. Thank you.